our federal recognition severed, and for 22 years, our people were cast adrift. But about halfway through that 22-year period, our people began to want to be re-recognized again, rebuild what we had at one time. So a restoration effort was started to restore the tribe and tribal status again in federal recognition. It took many, many years. And just to give you an example of the uphill fight that our people had regarding this issue, it's estimated that 1 in 10,000 bills that are introduced United States Congress actually becomes law. So you can see the odds that were against my efforts. I was a young man at the time of restoration. I was 18 or 19. In getting this controversial legislation passed through both houses of Congress and finally for the President's signature. But our people would not take no for an answer, and they struggled and they fought and they lobbied. And finally, in 1977, Congress passed this last Restoration Act, and it was signed into law on November 18th of that year by President Jimmy Carter. And a lot of you probably don't remember Jimmy Carter, if you remember him, but anyway, we had a huge success in doing so, but it meant that we had to rebuild. So we began organizing our government again from virtually nothing and adopted a constitution. We have tribal courts. We began to find ways to provide much needed services for our people. Housing, education, health services, things that were missing from our reservation for many years after the termination of the court. So this celebration that you're reading about and that you're hearing about, the tribe's 30th restoration celebration, is a monumental event for us. I'm glad that there's a generation now who remember termination. They who lived there in that time. I was born 2 years after the tribe was terminated. Just to give you an example of how it affected some families, I had half of my siblings, I have seven brothers and sisters of mine. Half of them were enrolled members of the tribe, but according to the federal government, no longer existed. And the other half, including myself, we were nothing in the eyes of the government. What they thought. So, in a nutshell, what happened to us? As we go forward, the Tlaxcala tribe has built many new structures. We have become the largest employer in Evergreen County. We donate a lot of money and services to many emergency services to the Tlaxcala tribe's charitable contributions fund. We have struggled to maintain our identity politically and culturally. The Athabasca language, that's less in community classes and in the Celeste Charter School. But that's just one aspect. A lot of people focus on either our language, dance, basketry, but to us it's all one whole. It's who we are, it's our birthright, it's our ancestry, and things are important to us. So with that, I thank you for having me here. Being able to share these things with you, we need to get out and do this more where we can talk with young people so they understand more about the land here, the ancestral Celeste land that we share today. All of you live here on this land, and we live here and we share it with you. So I thank you again for being able to be here, and I wish I could stay for the rest of the event here today, but I'm off to go start working on our Restoration Day celebration for tomorrow. So thank you very much.
quick, so please rise.
The allotment rolls were closed and there are
little on them than when they didn't pay the taxes. Landholders died and the children died. There was nobody to heir those lands. Many of Congress passed another act that limited tribal members to having their name on only one lawman. So when there were no tribal members to hold the deed of the lawman, the land was put for sale. The select Indian Affairs Agency with the proceeds limit among any known heirs. This is how many non-Indians now hold the lawman. The final and justified the people occurred only 53 years ago in 1954, when the United States government declared the tribal members no longer Indian. This was through the Western Oregon Termination Act, passed as Public Law 588 on August 13, 1953. It went on effect August 13, 1956. The law called for the sale of all tribal lands and deed to be issued. No health care treatment, no education was given. The BIA promoted termination by offering training to all tribal members that sent them out of the state to Colorado, Minnesota, and California. The only tribe not to be terminated in Oregon was the Warm Springs Confederate Tribes. On November 18, 1977, Congress passed Public Law 95-195, which was signed into law by President Jimmy Carter. That restored the Select Tribe to a federal relationship with the U.S. This reinstated much-needed health care, education, social assistance to tribes, and Select was the first tribe in Oregon and the second in the nation to achieve restoration. Many injustices were done by my ancestors. I hope that I have shared much with you and hope that you go on your own and learn more about the tribe you're related to.
Side we have men's traditional, men's grass, and men's bats and fancy. Our drum represents the heartbeat of the people, or the heartbeat of Mother Earth. It's not a stereotype drum beat you may hear on Ted Turner's baseball or some beer commercial you see on TV. It's not the Hollywood drum beat. That drum beat does not exist in any American Indian nations. What you hear today is the way we sing. We are not chanting. These are our songs, our powwow songs. That's on the tom-tom. That is a drum. It's made out of Latin America. It's like made out of horse hide. And we always give things to the animal life to give up their lives and even have a hide for the drum. And then also, you might want to see is, I should introduce Shirley Walker. Shirley Walker, please stand on our powwow circles. Known as a whip woman for the powwow circles, the sled strike, and the official whip woman. Her task at powwows and in the community is to take care of the dance arena or take care of the community. Any problems that people may have, they can come and see her. And she controls what goes on here in the arena while the women are dancing. We also have what we call an arena director. His name is Tony Whitehead. He couldn't be here today, but he controls what goes on inside the sled's arena. And so they're called whip men or whip women, and they get that title from generations of people in their family that come up to their family as important people in the powwow circles. And so their task is, if you have a guard on and you're not dancing, their task is to keep you out here around the arena. What you're going to see our dancers wear is called regalia, or outfits. We never call them costumes, because costumes are something you wear to be somebody you're not. And when our dancers take off their regalia or outfits, they're still Indian people. So we wear these outfits. Some are old, some are new, some are handed down through generations. So we wear these out of respect for our ancestors, the way they used to dress right back in the day. So we're going to start off with the, let's see, check my notes here, but my memory is shot. We're going to start off with the grass dancers. Drummers got the grass dance song ready. So the grass dancers, they come to the powwow circle by the way of the Omaha people. Don't get that confused with Omaha, Nebraska. These are Omaha people. And they're the grass dance society. Grass dancers are very spiritual dancers. They're the ones that would go out and find a new encampment for the nomadic tribes. If they were going to change their encampment from a summer to a winter encampment, or maybe a hunting lodge somewhere, they're really responsible for going out and blessing the area where this new encampment would be. Nobody would go there before they would. In some societies, these grass dancers are fierce warriors also, but today they're just nice, happy dancers. So we're going to invite out Buddha Butler, Keaton Fisher, Buddha's 8th grade, and Keaton Fisher's a 6th grader, and Ryland Fisher, 4th grade, all Celeste Tribal members.
Yeah.
Okay, next up will be Trudy Walker. She's going to show you the women's traditional style. Back in the day, women didn't dance in like dance arenas. Their task back in the day was to get the area ready for the men dancers. Back in the plains, where most of our powwow dances come from, the women folk, they would get the encampment ready for the men. The men may go on a hunting excursion or maybe doing war party of some sort, but they would come back to the encampment. And the women's job was to clean the encampment. What I mean by that, clean it spiritually. They would get it all ready for the dancers to come back. And the men's traditional dances, their dance style was to tell the story of the battle they may have been in or the hunting party they were in. And then come back and they'd dance that style. And each one had a different style of dancing, and they were telling the story of what happened and their experience. And the women would stand outside the circle where they were dancing and protect the dancers from any evil spirits coming into the dance arena. And so, but today, our elders got together about 100 years ago and decided that the women dancers could come into our dance arena and have their own category of dance style. So this is Shirley Walker, the real woman of the Celeste Tribe, and she's going to show you the men, women's traditional style. We call this the slow war dance style. Shirley Walker.
Thank you.